There are two great forces in the universe, silence and speech. Silence repairs, speech creates. Silence acts, speech gives impulse to action. Silence compels, speech persuades, said Sri Aurobindo on the 15th of August 1924. He was born in Calcutta on the 15th of August 1872. The 52 years in between, however, was not exactly a period of silence. His involvement in Indian politics is well known. Taking off humbly as a patriot, he went on to the position of the head of the Indian National Congress. As a political activist, he wrote profusely for different political journals, edited them, and lectured extensively on the prospect of the country's liberty. In 1910, Sri Aurobindo suddenly left the political arena and chose to withdraw to Pondicherry, a tiny French settlement on the southern shores of the Bay of Bengal. The shift should be attributed to quite a few factors, among which are included the dialectics of silence and speech. Aurobindo was born here in Calcutta and was sent to England by his highly anglicized father, K.D. Ghosh, at the age of 7, along with his two brothers. Brought up first in an English family at Manchester, he joined St. Paul's School in London in 1884. He left in 1890 with a senior classical scholarship to King's College, Cambridge, where he studied for 2 years. In 1890, he also passed the open competition for the Indian Civil Service. But at the end of 2 years in probation, he failed to present himself at the horse riding examination and was disqualified for the service. At this time, the Gaikwad of Baroda was in London. Aurobindo met him, obtained an appointment in the Baroda court, and left England in January 1893. So far, there was hardly any sign or manifestation of spiritual quality in his character. But on arrival at the Apollo Bandar in Bombay, a sudden realization surfaced. He felt a stupor, an absolute calm. I began to have spiritual experiences, but these were not divorced from this world, but they had an inner and infinite bearing on it. We must understand his statement in the background of his classical education in England. We also have to understand that according to his father's strict instructions, he received only Occidental education without any contact with the culture of India and the East. His long 14 years in Baroda was a kind of warming up through creative writing, mainly poetry, in which he had shown skill even in England.
He came to India on 6th of February 1893 and to Baroda on 8th of February 1893. And he immediately started his job in the secretariat of the Maharaja at that time. Then later on he shifted to the Baroda College as a part-time lecturer of French, and then he was fully appointed as a full-time professor of English, and there he started teaching, and then he rose to the post of vice principal, and he was acting principal also. Sri Aurobindo lived in this house at least from 1901 to 1906. Earlier also he must have lived here because Kasidas Jadhav was his friend, and he wrote a letter after his marriage from Nainital that now make some arrangement about my stay, and Kasidas Jadhav offered him this house only, and so he stayed here. Barindra and other people also came here. They were also staying along with him after marriage. So you can say that Baroda is a bridge in his consciousness between the West and the East. He acquainted himself with his Indian culture and Indian scripture and Indian philosophy only in Baroda.
As an employee of the Maharaja of Baroda, he was engaged in clerical activities and reading and writing until he met Vishnu Bhaskar Lele, the Maharashtrian yogi. Lele instructed him how to reach complete silence of the mind and immobility of the whole consciousness. Sri Aurobindo achieved it in just 3 days, with the result of lasting and massive spiritual realizations. He opened himself entirely to the hands of the divine within and moved only as he was moved. This experience was the foundation and became the principle of Sri Aurobindo's sadhana. But the aspiring sadhak still had to pass through a phase of trials. The freedom of the motherland was an issue intrinsic to his thought. He left Baroda in 1905 and openly joined the Indian political scene. Taking up the position of the principal of the newly founded Bengal National College in Calcutta. What struck him first was that the gospel of non-cooperation with the British government was vague. He contradicted the moderate leadership strongly. The ideological clash between the moderates and the nationalists, whom he led, changed the very face of Indian politics. Vande Mataram became his mouthpiece for a short while. The British rulers obviously located the seed of sedition in Sri Aurobindo's leadership. They put him behind bars on a false charge of criminal conspiracy in the Alipur bomb case. He was put into solitary confinement in Alipur jail. He spent almost all his time here in reading the Gita and the Upanishads and in intense meditation and the practice of yoga. He also had visions of Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Vivekananda. The meaning of yoga and its effect was revealed to him during solitary confinement. His sister and other well-wishers were scared that he might get corporal punishment. Sri Aurobindo remained calm and confident from within about an ensuing acquittal.
Thank you.
His friend, lawyer Chittaranjan Das, argued so strongly about his innocence that he was set free by the lawmakers after a year. Once out of jail, Sri Aurobindo did take up numerous lecture sessions to convince fellow Indians about the final mission of freedom. It was in Uttarpara, a satellite town to Calcutta, where he spoke publicly of his yoga and his spiritual experiences for the first time. There must have been various contending factors for the freedom movement to lead to a positive end. But Sri Aurobindo was the mastermind behind the creation of a new spirit in the country. He was not exactly against the philosophy of violence, since he knew that countries of the world had achieved freedom by violent resistance. But his sole aim was to act without a hue and cry. He realized that by being drawn inwards and calm within, one can demonstrate courage, integrity, and the power to resist the evil. Swaraj or nationalism, whatever you call it, he felt means complete self-sufficiency. Through two journals, Karma Yogi and Dharma, he started sending his message to the people. But in 1910, suddenly one day, Sri Aurobindo left Bengal by what has been described as a divine diktat. There was information about his rearrest. Sister Nivedita told him about it. Within 10 minutes of receiving the command from above, he left for Chandanagar, then a French territory, by a tiny Khatri boat. The date was the 4th of April 1910. Friend Motilal Rai arranged for this small place for him to stay. He was there for a month, and then by another command, left for Pondicherry, another French settlement in the south of India. The escape to the French territory was not just to avoid the British eyes. It was destiny working out a different strategy. In Pondicherry, he came first to stay in Shankar Chetty's house and was supported by the owner. But Sri Aurobindo had to shift to a few more places before settling in the address where he had lived for the next 40 years. Now his practice of yoga became more and more intense. He slowly dropped out of all participation in public activity, refused more than one request to preside over the Indian National Congress, and made a rule of abstention from any public utterance of any kind not connected with his spiritual activities. In 1928, Rabindranath Tagore came to meet him. They had met earlier in Raja Shobodh Mallik's house in Calcutta. Mallik was a well-wisher. He had donated a big amount of money when Bengal National College was established. No details of the poet's meetings are available, except that the poet could not talk for the rest of the day. After returning to the boat he was travelling in, to Sri Aurobindo, the principle of yoga was not only to realize the divine or to attain complete spiritual consciousness. He kept a close watch on all that was happening in India or the world and actively intervened whenever necessary with a spiritual force and a silent mind.
In Alipur jail, as you rightly put it, the alarm clock rang. It was the first phase was over and he believed that now he has to wake up to the greater part of his mission, the greater aspect of his mission, which was the transformation of human consciousness, for which he evolved his own yogic discipline. It was a new yoga because, as you know, practically the end of every spiritual discipline is to liberate us from the cycle of birth and death. But he did not see life as something just meant to be rejected and the soul to get away from the worldly environment or the worldly process of rebirth. He believed that since the divine has created this world, it had also a divine future. And that divine future can be possible only when human beings have become divinely enlightened integrally, that is, not simply in the realizing the soul, but the mind, all the source of our problems, our vital desires, all these things must be completely changed. They must become vehicles of the inner spirit, which is the divine spirit, even the physical body. It is a revolutionary concept, a mighty great concept.
The highest manifestation of Sri Aurobindo's philosophy was the ashram in Pondicherry. One can describe this place as an ideal location of life. The ashram was founded and was meant to be the cradle of the new world. The inspiration came from above. This observation is reflected in all activities and in each individual in the ashram.